In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. On the day of his baptism, Bill was welcomed into the church, given new life in Christ, and clothed with the garment of salvation. Today, we greet the body of our brother and surround him with the church's prayer. We commend our brother Bill to the mercy of God and pray that the promise made to him in baptism will be fulfilled. Let us pray. God of endless ages, from our generation to the next, you have been our refuge and strength. Before the mountains were born or the earth came to be, you are God. Have mercy now on your servant Bill, whose long life was spent in your service. Give him a place in your kingdom where hope is firm for all who love and rest is sure for all who serve. We ask this through our Lord Jesus, your Son, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Kindly be seated, please, for the first reading.
This is a reading from the book of Ecclesiastes. Beautiful reading. For everything, there is a season, a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, a time to pluck out what is planted, a time to kill, and a time to heal, a time to break down, and a time to build up, a time to weep, and a time to laugh, a time to mourn, and a time to dance, a time to throw away stones, and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek, and a time to lose, a time to keep, and a time to throw away, a time to tear, and a time to sow, a time to keep silence, a time to love, and a time to hate, a time for war, and a time for peace. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Second reading.
Paul's letter, the Colossians. As God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Bear with one another, and if anyone has a complaint against another, forgive each other, just as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. Above all, clothe yourself with love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony, and let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in the one body. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Teach and admonish one another with all wisdom and gratitude in your hearts. Sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs to God. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in me, and believe also in God. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you unto myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Lord Jesus Christ.
I have to say, this morning is like old home week. I remember 57 years ago at Transfiguration, the Dennis family occupied about two pews, and there was very little talking in the pews at the time, or they would get a look or a tap on the shoulder. And then as they grew a bit older, they started to serve at the altar and look after the poor priests in the office, answering phones, running the cassette, etc., etc. And as they grew even more, they looked after the young people when we had these unbelievable gatherings of teenagers, and the Dennis family was always, always there. So this morning, my friends, we come to celebrate in a very special way the life of William Alfred Dennis,
better known as Bill. A man of great faith, a husband to Grace, a father to Patricia, Paul, Marie, Michael, Jerry, Kathy, Peter, Terry, and Mark.
Did I miss anybody?
Proud papa to his 19 grandchildren and 20 great-grandchildren, and friend to many here this morning. We gather in faith and remember what we believe, that life has not ended. It has just begun again, or it has changed. We are here to celebrate Bill's journey to God. We are here because we believe in the church's teaching of everlasting life. Death is not the final curtain of one's life, or it is the beginning of a new stage with God. As our producer and director, and how fortunate we are to have such a creative God. A human life goes forward like a wave rolling toward the shore. Then comes the moment of life and death, and we return home to the God who gave us life in the very beginning of our age. In our first reading this morning, read very well by my former altar boy, who's now in his 60s.
And he won't admit it.
Anyways, we hear the very beautiful words for every person and every place and in every circumstance. There is a time to be born and there is a time to die. God has appointed the times and the seasons, the events of our lives, the happy and the sad, the easy and the difficult. On the one hand, this can bring worry, but on the other, it will bring us hope, because we know that God is truly in our lives. And yes, God is our source of life, and he is there but for the asking. And our second reading from Paul's letter to the Colossians is a prescription for living the best we can. We hear the words, the beautiful words, clothe yourselves with compassion and kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Bear with one another, forgive one another, clothe yourselves with love. And I know that Bill lived those ideals of Christian life to the best of his ability, especially with Grace and all the children. And I remember fondly back in 1965 when I first was assigned to Transfiguration and introduced to the Dennis family on the Westway. I often wondered how in the world they managed to live in such confined quarters with 11 in one bathroom. It'd be like living on a farm. You'd have five back houses out there, of course, and many weeds catalogs. But they did it. And they did it well. They managed. With the girls in the rectory office answering the phones and the boys serving at the altar, there was a real sense of belonging, to a family of faith with the Dennis clan. They reminded me so much of my own father, his family, the farm of 13 children, And often when my mom and dad were there in the summer, dad would say to mom, you know, sweetheart, I was born right on this table. And my mother says, we're eating now, dear. We have to talk about that. He was so proud to be born on the farm. In a large family, you learn the basic words of every community. The two words that we need to say often, thank you for giving. Two words which nourish the heart and soul of family living, and Bill and Grace, I am sure, made many sacrifices to benefit their children and eventually all the future ventures of their family. The message of the Gospel of John. This assurance that God is with us in our journey through life until death is not just a story of faith, but more so a reality of a deep and compassionate God who loves us beyond our own telling. And to quote John, the words, for this is the will of my Father, that everyone who sees the Son and believes in him may have eternal life, and I shall raise them up on the last day. And so this morning, my friends, you've come here because of your belief, but because of your love of this man. We come to bury his body, but not his spirit. We come to bury his voice, but not his message. We come to bury his hands, but not his good works. We come to bury his heart, but not his love. For it is never easy, never easy, to say goodbye to someone we have loved so dearly, respected so keenly, and honored so greatly, especially by his family and friends. But that is what we are doing here this morning, bidding our farewells and knowing in faith that God has welcomed our husband, our father, our grandfather, our great-grandfather, our friend, into his new and eternal home. For he is now at peace. Kindly stand now, please, for the intercessions. If we trust in God, he will take care of us in life and in death. Let us pray with confidence to him in this our hour of need.
Our response to the petition is, Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Now that Bill's labors and sufferings are over, may God bring him to a place of light, happiness, and peace. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
that God would comfort us who mourn for Bill and help us to comfort one another, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the family of Bill, that he may be remembered by his wife, Grace, his family, and all his friends, and may God strengthen them in this time of mourning, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the memory of Bill will live on in our hearts, and our feelings of love for him will stay with us until we all meet again, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord God, giver of peace and healer of souls, hear the prayers of the Redeemer Jesus Christ and the voice of your people, whose lives were purchased by the blood of the Lamb. Forgive whatever harm we may have done, and for all who sleep in Christ, and grant them a place in your kingdom, we ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Kindly be seated, please, for the offertory. Pray, my friends, that your sacrifice and mine may be acceptable to our Heavenly Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice in your hands, for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all his
church. As we humbly present to you these sacrificial offerings, O Lord, for the salvation of your servant Bill, we beseech your mercy that he who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Savior may find in him a merciful Judge who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your
spirit. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be comforted by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. So with the angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your lasting glory. So that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you by the same Spirit, graciously grant me these gifts that we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become for us the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. Again, he gave you thanks and praise, gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant. It will be shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith. With your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, Advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth with your servant Francis, our Pope.
Douglas,
our bishop.
I'm going on the diet.
And your servant, Pope again, right? Pope Francis, right?
Please go ahead, thank God.
Listen graciously to the prayers,
Lord, I'm sorry.
The prayers of the family brought here this morning in your compassion, merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our, remember also your servant Bill, whom you have called today from our world unto yourself. Grant that he who was united with your son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection. When from the earth he will raise up in flesh those who have died, transform our lowly body after the pattern of his own glorious body. And so to our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom, for there we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall become like you for all ages and praise you without end, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
And so, my friends, we stand. Call to mind the love of God as we pray the beautiful words, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from all evil. Grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin, safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus, you said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church. You grant to us the peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
May you sincerely offer that peace in whatever way you can, whatever way you feel, asking God to be with each person here this morning. Go ahead. You can kiss and shake whatever you wish. Peace, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Again, please kneel or be seated, whatever your custom may be. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you. Only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Now at communion time, if you are Catholic and disposed to receive the Eucharist, by all means, come forward. And if you are not Catholic, well, of course, this is one of the areas where we haven't come together yet. Let's hope one day we will. But you're here, I hope, because you believe in God. And if you wish to come forward and receive a blessing from the Eucharistic ministers, just hold your hands like that, and so we'll know who you are. So that's entirely up to you. Because really, someday we'll get you all anyway, so. Okay, here we go. Oh, yes. Body of Christ here. Body of Christ. Body of Christ. Body of Christ. So we just come up in two lines as your inaugural liturgy.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you for the gift you have given us in the Eucharist, that we always be strengthened by your food and by your word. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Kindly be seated now, please, for the final commendation prayers. Trusting in God, we have prayed together for Bill, and now we come to the last farewell. There is sadness in parting, but we take great comfort in the hope that one day we shall see Bill again and enjoy his friendship. Although this assembly will disperse in sorrow, the mercy of God will gather us together again in the joy of his kingdom. Therefore, let us console one another in the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ. In baptism, Bill shared in the death and resurrection of Christ. May he now be welcomed into the glory of everlasting life. And as a sign of respect for our brother Bill, we let incense rise to God, who has called him to share in his glory. I would now ask John McIsaac to come forward to say a few words of eulogy. And there's John. Okay. You can sit down. Okay. Don't fall. Oh. You know what? You look exactly like Bill. You're as tall as he is, not quite as big.
Thank you for that tribute.
I'll miss you up a little bit.
We might be on a tour together.
You're not friends.
On January 18th, 1928, at St. Michael's Hospital, Bill was born to William and Irene Dennis, the second of six children. In his formative years, Bill was recognized as a double threat, a male model for Eden's Canada, who, yes ladies, also played the tuba. Just more of that image. A proud alumnus of St. Mike's, Bill's faith played an important part in his life, and his greatest faith was placed in people. Among them, I am certain, is everyone gathered here today. After he gave up the catwalk and put down the tuba, Bill left school and took a job with Imperial Oil. It was 1947, and with his father's sudden death, Bill answered the call. He selflessly set aside any aspirations he may have had of college or university, and began what would become a more than 40-year career at Imperial Oil, starting out in the nail room. And he did so with one goal in mind, not for his own advancement, but for the care and comfort of his family. As the oldest and only surviving son to a widowed mother, Bill saw that as his duty. Duty, that's a theme he carried throughout his life. This next story has been told many times, but we can't help but marvel at it every time we hear it. In 1968, at the age of 40, with nine children and a full-time job, Bill Dennis decided it was time to go back to school. He spent the ensuing 5 years studying for and successfully completing his accounting designation, a registered industrial accountant. I've never met anyone who can make that claim. It speaks volumes to his perseverance, and equally as impressive, it is a testament to the dedication and sacrifice made by his loving wife, Grace. I mentioned Bill was my mother's younger brother. For me, he was Uncle Bill, but he was also many things to many people. William Alfred Dennis, Bill, husband, dad, brother, brother-in-law, cousin, uncle, grandpa, papa, great man. Now, while Bill answered to all of these, he was perhaps better known for the quality of his character. He had plenty of qualities, and he was most certainly a character. Here are a few words used to describe him: selfless, generous, humble, funny, witty, compassionate, loving, sincere, dedicated, faithful, loyal, caring, empathetic, inclusive, attentive, tireless, patient. I saw a video that Mike sent earlier this week of Aunt Grace's 65th birthday. Watch me now as I steal one of Bill's jokes from that day. That list of remarkable qualities I just read, it was actually a little longer. I just had trouble reading Bill's handwriting. Over this past week, I've had the opportunity to hear the stories and countless memories Bill and Grace created over many years. I mentioned Bill and Grace in the same breath because they were and always will be inseparable. There could be no Bill without Grace, no Grace without Bill. Reflecting on some of those qualities, I realized what a tremendous legacy we have been given. And what is that legacy? Look to your left. Look to your right. Look all around you. The people in this church and those elsewhere whose lives Bill touched are the core of that legacy. And so, I urge each of you to cherish every moment and be grateful for the experience you shared with him. Now, if I could, I'd like to speak to some of those memories which so beautifully reflect Bill's character. I mentioned his selflessness and generosity. Patty recalled one Christmas when Bill and Grace took in two young boys from a local orphanage. They were fed, given shelter, provided with Christmas gifts. And all the while, Bill and Grace still showed the consistent dedication and love to their own family of nine children. fact, the dentist door was open to everyone. Bill and Grace surely spent a fortune replacing broken hinges. My own brothers and sisters recall fondly childhood sleepovers at the dentist's house on the West Way. As you'll hear later, Bill wasn't much of a poker player, and this may offer some explanation. Between the orphans, the cousins, and the countless other visitors, he clearly did not understand the meaning of a full house. We noticed back then he made a point to show great interest in us, in his children's friends, in-laws, and those beyond the immediate family. He was the definition of a family man, and that was true whether it was his family or someone else's. When he retired, Imperial Loyalist management asked Bill how he wanted to be recognized for the more than 40 years of service. His request was a simple one: to have his family join him for an elegant meal served at the company's head office at 111 St. Clair. Private dining, top floor. Bill's notion of being honored was to humbly step aside and let others bask in that light. Similarly, when you speak to Bill's pride, you need go no further than the too many to count family pictures hung lovingly on the wall at their house. I remember the first time I saw that display. I was sure I was in a museum. He was Dennis Proud. On his inclusivity, his attentiveness, and his caring nature, I mentioned how Bill always made a point to draw people into the conversation. He was just involved. He regularly attended school and sporting events to watch family members of all ages. He took the time to speak to newcomers, to make them feel welcome. He always showed a genuine interest in school results, friends, and careers. He regularly inquired about the well-being of in-laws. Julie recalled what great comfort Bill provided when she lost her father, saying to her, "It's okay, I'm here for you now." I knew that would get you, Julie. He was ever present when a family member had a problem, was in need, or found themselves in trouble. And with 9 kids, I imagine that sort of stuff happens once in a while. Through his example, he encouraged others to be tolerant, to put themselves in other shoes, to understand, to have compassion. And Bill was also able to multitask. He could sometimes combine 2 qualities at one time. In one instance, he demonstrated both his evolving technical skills and his stubbornness. Well into his later years, he was an avid user of email, but as I mentioned, he could be stubborn at times. So it comes as no surprise that while he was technically sound, he wasn't about to surrender the BlackBerry without a fight. Then there were the annual gentlemen's golf tournaments in the Laurentians, and I could see Jerry and Pete and Terry squirming in their seats. "Don't worry, fellas, you're always safe in church. And what happened in Lac Manitou stays in Lac Manitou." Now, Bill wasn't described as being a particularly adept at golf, and I mentioned his poker skills earlier, but he would show up for the golf, and he'd also be there with a roll of loonies for each of the grandkids before the poker game. He was there for family when it meant something. Bill loved a good pun or the turn of a phrase. Who could forget his favorite hotel, the Do Drop In, or his favorite law firm, Dewey, Cheatham, and Howell? Or the time he was driving Mike to hockey practice, Mike pointed out his French teacher, Miss Kennedy, had just passed him. Without missing a beat, Bill said, "Well, that'll be the only time she passes you." Aunt Grace chose a worthy partner, and together they made the world a much better place. Bill's love for Grace was without limitation or restriction. He supported her, she supported him. When he was asked about the best decision he ever made, he said without pause, "Marrying Grace." To the family, Grace, the sons, daughters, spouses, partners, 19 grandchildren, and 20 great-grandchildren, and as we remember Mark today, you have suffered a great loss, and you will experience this in many different ways in the days and weeks to come. But time is the great healer, and when the sorrow begins to ease, it's my hope you will cherish and celebrate the memories Bill and Grace have given you. Evidence of a life well-lived is found in those you leave behind. The character, compassion, and humanity Bill showed us us to share with others. I'll leave you with the words of playwright, author, and Pulitzer Prize winner Thornton Wilder, who said simply, "The highest tribute to those who have passed on is not grief, but gratitude. Let each of us be grateful." God bless you all.
Wonderful. You can get the homily next time.
Thanks very much, John. Just a bit of housekeeping. We're so grateful for Monsignor Shields and the San Andrew staff and the Corpiva Taylor staff and all the great work. Immediately following the session, we're moving next door to a reception with a light lunch. You're all welcome, but don't feel compelled. And then after that, we'll go to the internment around 1 o'clock. So again, you're welcome to join, but don't feel compelled.
Okay. Question: are the drinks light too, or
have the drinks ever been light?
Kindly stand, please. Let us pray. Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our brother Bill, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will raise up on the last day. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant and help us to remain, to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and our brother forever and ever. Amen. In peace, my friends, let us take our brother to his place of rest. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Thank you, Toby. You did great.
Oh, thank you.
Wandering all over the place, was I?
No, really.
Oh, well, they like to see light bulbs.
See you, the guy.